Never Alone is a love story that's very personal to me. My little sister was a recording artist. 3 years ago, she unfortunately was victim of her own mental unease, and she died by suicide. And she died the day where she had finished her second album. So for me to be able to dive into who we are as artists, what we have to offer, what our secret worlds are, and how we share that inner world with you all might be the solution to help people who are struggling in the invisible world of their own mental health. And that's why Never Alone Artists exists. And hopefully we shall create a beautiful movement of healing and loving presence. So thank you for joining us. We'll see where it goes. Welcome to another episode of Never Alone Artists. It's very exciting today because we have this wonderful goddess here sitting next to us, Jhene. When did your spiritual journey, if I could call it as such, start? And when did you first want to share it with the world?
Yeah, so my spiritual journey, I believe, started when I was about 5 or 6, when I had just met my great-grandmother and was getting to spend a lot of time with her, and shortly after she passed away. And from that point, I just sort of always had these questions and been a seeker of, you know, what does it mean to live? What does it mean to die? And I was homeschooled, so I had a lot of time to just sit and think and stare at flowers and the sky and butterflies. And my grandmother, my mom's mom, she introduced me to Christianity and Sunday school. And then when my great-grandmother passed, my grandfather's mom, she had a Buddhist ceremony. Mm-hmm. So I was introduced to that at a very young age. And then when my brother passed in 2012, that was a pivotal moment for sure in my spiritual journey, and I started to dive even deeper into the things that I had been taught when I was younger, and reading more and more books. And my brother himself, when he was sick, he started to read more about the Buddha, and, you know, he sort of opened up more spiritually, I noticed. He fought for two years, and yes, but I believe it started when I was about five years old.
It's interesting because I think we share a similar story. Mm. I was about 6 and a half. My parents were in England. My father was training to be a cardiologist. I and my little brother, who was then about 4, I was maybe closer to 7. And one day we got a telegram from England that my father had passed all his exams and he was now a member of the Royal College of Physicians. My grandfather, who was a World War I sergeant at that time, retired of course, he was so proud of his son that we went to the rooftop of our apartment in Mumbai as it's called now. And he had a rifle and he shot some rounds in the sky to celebrate. Then he took my brother and me to a movie. I still remember the movie. It's Ali Baba and the 40 Thieves. And then we went to a carnival. Then we went to a dinner. And then I woke up in the middle of the night and I heard some crying and he had died. And all I remember of that night is that I was carried in the lap of our house servant, as he was called at that time. Mm-hmm. He was our baby, basically he was our nanny.
Nanny, yes.
And he carried me and my little brother to a neighbor's apartment. The next day they took him for cremation and brought back his ashes in a jar. And one of my uncles, who was actually a film director in Bollywood, he said, well, what's a human being? One day he was celebrating with his kids and his grandkids, and the next day he's a bunch of ashes. So I heard that statement, and I had what you might call the dark night of the soul at the age of seven. Mm-hmm. My little brother started to started to get sick. He later went on to become the dean of medical education at Harvard Medical School, but I remember this, 4 years of age, his skin started to peel. And my uncles took him to every possible doctor. They couldn't make a diagnosis till one Ayurvedic healer, as it turned out, said he's feeling vulnerable, he's losing his skin. He's shedding his skin because of his vulnerability. When his parents come back, he'll be fine. Sure enough, that's what happened. So in hindsight, that was the beginning of my spiritual journey, my desire to be a doctor, my brother's desire to be a doctor, and subconsciously my interest in mind-body medicine, because that was a perfect example. Mm. And what it means to have a life. And I've realized since then, and you know, it took me a long time, went to medical school, started writing books, read about other people's spiritual journeys. It took me a long time to realize that what we call everyday existence, this, is a lucid dream in a vivid now. So if I asked you what happened to your childhood, the answer is it's a dream. Mm-hmm. What happened to our teenage years? The answer is, it's a dream. What happened to yesterday? It's a dream. What happened to this morning? It's a dream. What happened to 5 minutes ago when you came here? It's a dream. What happens to these words by the time you hear them? They don't exist. So going back to the Buddha, he said, this lifetime of ours is transient as autumn clouds. To watch the birth and death of beings is like looking at the movements of a dance. A lifetime is like a flash of lightning in the sky, rushing by like a torrent down a steep mountain. To complete this, it's not a new idea. You know, Wittgenstein, the great German philosopher, said, our life is a dream. We are asleep. But once in a while, we wake up to know enough that we are dreaming. And so I started to wonder, and since you brought up, you know, your fascination with the teachings of the Buddha, as everyone knows, when he was passing away finally, one of his disciples, Ananda, said, who are you? Which question we ask every day in meditation.
Yes,
who
we
am
do.
I, right?
We do.
And the Buddha kept quiet, and then he said, I mean, there are many versions of the story. He said, are you a prophet? He said, no. Are you a messenger? He said, no. Are you a messiah? No. Are you God? No. He said, Ananda got frustrated. He said, before you leave, tell me, who are you? What are you? And the Buddha's answer was, I'm awake. I'm awake. So that became my journey, lifetime journey.
Beautiful.
How do we wake up from human to what we now call
meta-human.
So that's my story. And, you know, you inspired me just now to share that story.
Thank you.
Where are you spiritually now? What do you feel about yourself, your identity?
I am open. I feel that's where I'm at right now. I am open. I'm awake sometimes. I also love to sleep. I'm a dreamer. And I feel infinite.
Beautiful.
She's waking up.
She's on her way.
Any questions you have?
a billion questions. First, thank you.
Oh, sure.
I just want to say thank you for all that you do. I was going to bring my book for you to sign, but this is...
We'll send you one.
Okay. I mean, I feel like all the questions I have, you've answered in so many ways throughout your books and continuously reading them. Like, I read Seven Spiritual Laws consistently, and I always learn something
more.
New. Mm. Yeah. And it meets me where I'm at, you know, in life. So when the first time I read it, I didn't get as much from it as I get from it now, because I think I can understand more of it now. The law of least effort is something that I really applied to the making of my Chalumbo album, which is, Chalumbo is my last name. It ain't perfect, but everything's beautiful now. So my last album, I was telling everyone, you guys should read this book. And what I'm practicing right now is the law of least effort. Let's just surrender to the moment. Let's trust the universe. We won't have to try so hard, you know, and let's just be, and it's gonna happen. It's gonna happen. And the more and more we practice that, and we just opened ourselves up, and we got in this flow where we didn't have to try.
Yeah.
It just happened.
Just had to be.
We just had to be. We just had to be. And so, thank you. I should send you a plaque for the album, because that really helped to keep that in mind.
So, you know, by the way, that's also my favorite, because right now there's so much conflict in the world because people are trying so hard, driving ambition, exacting plans, goal setting, all for the gratification of the ego. But when you really let go, you flow. And
yes,
that's what peak experiences are. Peak living is no anticipation, no resistance, no regrets. Flow with the river. Let it take you where it goes. And what you realize is that ultimately, that's the highest intelligence, subtle intention, choiceless awareness, allowing the divine to flow. So there's no resistance to existence. Once there's resistance to existence, then the divided mind takes over,
and we all suffer, which is why we feel alone, which is why we feel desperation, which is why we feel the endless tunnel of suffering, and which is ultimately relates to the crisis that we're in today, which is a huge mental health crisis, which is a huge almost like humanity crisis. It's the fact that we don't know who we are, we don't find our place in the world. It's hard to, we don't know how to even question our reality, because it's so horrid what we perceive. That it's experiencing tragedy with not knowing how to get out of it. And I feel that what we're trying to attempt here with Never Alone Artist is to really highlight the pockets of joy, the pockets of inspiration that occurs from being an artist. Because being an artist is, you're in a leadership position, and yet it's so vulnerable. But sometimes it could be lonely. Mm. Was there ever a moment for you where you felt the most loneliest in your life, and that you had a bridge where you could find the light?
You know, I've never felt lonely.
That's wonderful.
I've never felt lonely. I grew up in the house with two older sisters, two older brothers, lots of cousins. So I found myself actually seeking solitude when I got older. Like,
you know the difference between loneliness and solitude. Loneliness is when you're alone. Solitude is when you're with everyone. Right?
Yes.
So because of who you are, and because you express yourself so beautifully, and because you have such a huge impact, we're asking you to share with your audience, mm-hmm. the importance of what we call Sangha, community, mm-hmm. where we give each other attention, deep listening, yeah. affection, deep caring, appreciation, deep gratitude, and acceptance. Mm. Total acceptance, radical acceptance of who we are. I call these the four A's, and if we can actually execute them, we can actually create a pandemic of happiness in the world. And
I like that.
Pandemic, we're asking you to help us.
Yes.
I would love to.
I was going to say as well that there have been times when I wanted company and maybe no one was available. And I had to learn to sit with myself and enjoy my own company and my own presence. And because I have this fascination with my family and our roots and my ancestors, and even like my brother who is now a part of the cosmos, he's always with me, you know? I never feel alone. I have had a few cats in my life that have gone on to either live in the wild or to the cosmos, and I feel their presence even with me. All of my ancestors, I feel, are always with me.
That's beautiful.
And so I also just feel connected to everyone else, you know? And so I never feel lonely, and I would just, my advice to anyone that feels lonely, just remember that you are your family, you embody your ancestors, you embody your friends, and when you are by yourself, they're with you too, they're a part of you too.
So true.
And right this moment, all your ancestors, all of them, from all over the world, are speaking through you. Everything you say requires their genes,
yes.
and their presence in your body right now. So this is a conversation honoring your ancestors and you as a global citizen helping us all go beyond our tribal minds.
Yeah.
Because most of the world is still stuck in a tribal medieval identity with modern capacities for destruction. That's very dangerous. So please continue to what you're doing.
Thank you.
And
thank you so much.
Know that we support you and we hope you support us. Never
yes.
alone.
Yes.
Dot love is our program. And Gabriella,
and we're
so honored to
yes,
have you.
Yes, we're
right?
so honored to have you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Sharing. I feel that in this episode we have gone into what is life after death. And I think, you know, through this period of not only the pandemic, also losing people that we love in the world. I think this is a beautiful eye-opener into healing and into the next phase of what absence can create. And absence can create great presence of being. So you're never alone.
That's very beautifully said. I'd just like to add one more thing.
Please do.
Death is not the opposite of life, okay? Death is the opposite of birth. Yes. Birth and death are the continuum of life. Death makes birth possible, and birth makes death possible. Who you are is beyond life and death, beyond birth and death.
Birth and death.
So who you are is never born and never gone.